be mindful in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The preacher never asks a congregation to do something like I'm going to ask you to do right now. I'm going to ask you to empty your mind of all the worries that you brought with you this morning. And the way I want to do this is actually to close your mind, your eyes. No, don't close your mind. Close your eyes. And I want you to empty your mind. And if you do that for me right now, I'm not going to let you fall asleep, so don't worry about that. But just, I'm going to say a phrase. What I want you to do when I say that phrase, think about what that phrase means to you in your mind. Ready? St. Mark's Church. Okay, you can open up. Okay, open up, open up! You're with me. I want to do something a little different today. It's my last day, and if you don't like it, in some ways, what I want to do is I want to share with you from my heart. One of the first things we learned in our confirmation classes is that the church is not a building. It's not a hierarchy of bishops, priests, and deacons. It's not all the theological niceties of theological discussion. It's people. The church is people. You are the church. I wonder what image came into your mind when I said St. Mark's Church. Was it people? Or was it a building? It doesn't matter. You think about that. Now, in 48 years, Dorothy and I have met some wonderful people, and we include you in that. We have met some wonderful people. And at times, when we get in a kind of a reverie mode, we start recalling the people that have been part and parcel of our ministry. People that we ministered to, but conversely, people who have ministered to us. And what I'd like to do today, I'm going to keep you here till about 4 o'clock. I'm going to reflect on some of the people that we've met and what they meant to us over the years. I want to start, these are not in any kind of chronological order. I'm going to start with a fellow by the name of John, he went by the name Jack. He was a controversial figure, a world traveler, a theologian, a Bible scholar. We first met this man at the airport in Vancouver when he agreed to come to Sorrento Center when I was the executive director. And he brought his wife with him, and we were going to invite him to speak to the people at Sorrento. He came a couple of times. At the time that I want to remember, we were no longer at Sorrento, but he was coming back again, and we had agreed to host him at our home overnight, and then we were going to take him up to Sorrento so he could do another series of lectures at Sorrento. And so we took off early in the morning, and up across the Coca-Cola, and guess what happened? The transmission of the car went. And we had to coast from where we were into Cambridge, which we were lucky enough because it was basically downhill. We could get the transmission into first gear, but that was all. And so we chugged down the hill into Cambridge. And the first gas station we came to, we could take this gentleman up to Sorrento to give his week's study. And it took a while to get hold of the bishop, and it took a while for the bishop to clear his calendar and to come looking for us. So while we were there, this man went into the little store that was there, you know, that sells all kinds of things when you, in a service station. And you know what? Within about 40 minutes, this gentleman found out all there was to know about the young lady that was looking after the store. He was able to talk to her. If he talked to her like he talked to me, then you were the most important person in the world to him. He had no time for anyone else but you. And he opened up himself and enabled me to open up myself to him, to share our journey of faith together. That man influenced my life so deeply that I followed him in terms of his Bible study. He affected me that deeply. And I think he will affect me for the rest of my life, because he committed himself strictly to me as he did to that young lady in the service station. And he's a Christian. He's a member of the church. That's what the church is all about. When I first went to the parish of Lamerton, which is in central Alberta, it consists of a three-point parish down on Highway 21, Bashaw, Mer, and Alex. I was just young in ministry. I'd only spent 2 years as a curate in a large parish, and I was sent off into the world. See what you can do, you know, and I was so gung-ho, I was ready to change the world by Tuesday at noon. And part of that ministry was the hospital at that time was running on a kind of a volunteer ambulance system. And they phoned and said, "We think you might like to drive the ambulance." I said, you know, I don't know much about first aid or anything, but back in those days, and this is back in the 70s, you didn't have to be one of these professionally trained medical technicians that they have in ambulances now. If you had your industrial first aid, so it's on the ambulance, if you had your first aid and a license, you could drive an ambulance. And the ambulance in Bashaw was not equipped with a siren. It had flashing lights, but 90% of its time was on the highway. You don't hear the siren on the highway. And I said that I would do that work, provided it didn't interfere with my ministry. I wasn't going to wait at home waiting for them to call. But if I was at home and if I was not committed, I'd be glad to drive the ambulance. I just got back into the house, the phone rang. They were asking me if I would go to the farm, pick a gentleman up, and take him to Edmonton. Now, I was in my collar. I had no time to change. So I got into the ambulance, picked up the attendant, and went out to the farm. I was going to pick this gentleman up, and for whatever reason, which I didn't know, I was taking him up to the hospital in Edmonton, about an hour and a half drive. And when the lady, the wife, came out, she saw me in my collar. And she said to me, "Do you know more than they're telling you about?" And then that's when I realized I had my collar off. And it would be a question to ask. That was a special part of my ministry as a kind of a response back to the community. And it was a challenging and exciting part of that ministry that I have in Bashaw. I went to another parish, was there for about between 7 and 8 years. Mm-hmm. Wonderful parish, wonderful people, as in practically every place that I've ever been, there's been wonderful parishes and wonderful people, because the church is made up of wonderful people, people who make a commitment to Jesus Christ, however they understand that commitment, and they present themselves, some Sunday by Sunday, some in other kind of understandings of presenting themselves, but you get to know them, and I talk for myself, you get to love them, and you get to cherish them. George had been in the hospital for a month while I was away on holiday, which we didn't know about until we got back. And the first thing I did when we got back was to run around and see George at the hospital. Now, George was a big, stocky guy. He was a captain of a fire brigade in the city of Winnipeg. So, you know, he knew how to handle himself. But he was really loved the day I walked in there. He had come in with some kind of problem for which, over a month, the medical authorities couldn't determine what it was. I'm always amazed at the wonderful understanding of medical today, what they can do and how they do it. But I'm also amazed at what they don't know and what they stumble over. And in this particular case, this is going back quite a number of years, they stumbled over George. Not only did they stumble over George, that they put him in the hospital, and what would you think? That he picked up two of the superbugs that are in the hospital. So not only did they not know what the real cause was, they had to determine how to fight superbugs in his life. And when I went in, he was down and he said, "Hey, superbug." He started to cry and he said, "I'm never going to get home. I came in here, you know, feeling reasonably well, though I had a little bit of a problem. But since I've been here, I've been going down and down and down." And he said, "The next stop is the morgue." Now, I did something you're not supposed to do. I said to him, "You're going to go home." Well, he would have gone home one way or the other, but you're not supposed to tell people in hospital things you don't know. If you don't know, don't say. You can encourage, but don't encourage them into areas that you don't know. But I told him, "You're going to go home." And in fact, I said, "I'm going to come and visit you every day until I take you home." I never made that commitment before or since. George was in the hospital for another 4 months after that commitment. 120 days that I visited George every day for 120 days. About halfway through, I was running late that one night, and it was about 10 o'clock in the evening before I actually got into the hospital to see George. And it was amazing because his face broke into a great smile. He was glad to see me, and he said, "I didn't think you were going to make it today." And I said, "Never did I, but I'm here. I made a commitment and I'm here." You know what? George did get better. More by the grace of God than I would think about a medical processes at that time. And it was one of the great joys of my ministry to be able to drive George home, hand him over to his wife, after 5 months in hospital. I learned two things from George. Never make a commitment unless you're prepared to follow it through. And if you do make a commitment, know that the person that you made the commitment to looks for you to fulfill that commitment. That was a very important learning for me in my ministry. So, the church is made up of people. face of God in each and every one of you. And there I have found God sitting at the table in the kitchen over a cup of coffee or tea and a muffin. I've seen God in the face of people as you sit in a front room and enjoy a glass of sherry. Did I ever tell you at the time that in my first parish, the rector had to say to people, stop serving this till I sherry. You can't handle more than one glass of sherry a day, and you're giving him too much. And I didn't know how to say to people, no. Right at the beginning of my ministry, I didn't know how to say no for a cup of a glass of sherry. I always said yes if they asked me, yes.
Christ and ministry among us. John and Doug have been here for 6 years with a 2-year hiatus. That first four were so good, we brought them back. But this is the capstone in many ways of 48 years of really continuous ministry. That is a great heritage. And he came to us loaded with years and experience. You've heard a bit of that. We didn't have to do any training. He's walked alongside of me as a partner, sharing the load and the burden of work here so faithfully and with so many gifts and talents. We are going to miss them. They're just down the road, so we may get to see them from time to time. But we want to pray for them. Just before I pray for John and Dorothy, and let me say that unless you know them personally and have a sense to walk closely along, so you never know the role of a minister's wife, a pastor's wife. In this case, a team, very much a team who has stood together, and she has supported this man and has served alongside him in so many ways here in St. Mark's in the ministry of prayer and many other very special ways. So we've come to love them both so much. I'm going to read for you a letter from our bishop, and this would be a good way to finish these remarks. Before I pray, this is addressed to the people of the parish of St. Mark, Ocean Park. Dear people of St. Mark's, I write today to acknowledge and honor the Reverend John Ash, who has been serving as assistant priest at St. Mark's, most recently for the last 2 years. John is now making a transition to full retirement. John is a person of outstanding gifts. He is warm, encouraging, dedicated, and articulate. During his 30-plus years in ordained ministry, he has served in a number of roles: executive director, rector, regional dean, etc., all of which he has discharged with energy and a gospel-centered faithfulness. I have been especially grateful to John and his wife, Dorothy, in their service to the diocese as chaplains to retired clergy for the last 3 years. I can tell you from my experience that people like John will never be replaced. Instead, all we can do is to seek to find worthy successors for him. I know that you will miss John and Dorothy as he leaves his role. At the same time, I know you will join with me in wishing both of them well as they enjoy some well-deserved time for themselves. With gratitude for all of you and for John and Dorothy on this day, in Christ, Melissa, Archbishop, Diocese of New Westminster, Metropolitan of the Ecclesiastical Province of British Columbia and the Yukon. Isn't that nice to have? Praise the Lord. Would you bow with me in prayer for these two very wonderful people, loving God? As John has spoken to us about people who become so important in our life and memory, people who are your people, the face of God to us, they stand here now in that place for us. And they have earned a spot in our memories and in our hearts that is well deserved. We will miss them. We send them forth with reluctance, but we send them forth with our blessing, our prayers, our great well-wishes for them. We pray that you will help them through the recent physical issues both John and Dorothy have encountered. And beyond that, into long and full and healthy and prosperous life, a life of love with their family, their children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, a life of continued service and ministry in whatever ways you make possible for them. We love them, Lord, and we commit them to you. In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.